Satyavati was the queen of the Kuru king Shantanu of Hastinapura and the great-grandmother of the Pandava and the Kaurava princes. She is also the mother of the seer Vedavyasa, the author of the epic. Her story appears in the Mahabharata, the Harivamsham, Devi Bhagavata Purana. According to the Harivamsa, Satyavati in her previous life was an Achoda, a daughter of the Pitras, that is the ancestors, and cursed to be born on earth. The Mahabharata, Harivamsa and Devi Bhagavata Purana asserts that Satyavati was the daughter of a cursed Apsara named Adrika. Adrika, who was transformed by a curse into a fish and lived in the Yamuna river. According to the legend, Vasu, also known as Uparichara Vasu, a Chedi king, was on a hunting expedition one day. While he was tired hunting, he slept under a tree and took rest. In his dream, he unknowingly ejaculates, dreaming of his wife. He did not want to waste the semen, so he used an eagle to send his semen wrapped up in a leaf to his queen. But the eagle fought with another eagle mid-air and the semen fell into the river and which was swallowed by the cursed Adrika fish. Consequently, the fish became pregnant. Soon, a fisherman caught the pregnant fish and cut it open to found two babies in the womb of the fish, one male and one female. The fisherman was surprised, so he presented the children to the king, who kept the male child, and the boy grew up to become the king of Matsya and the founder of the Matsya kingdom. And the king gave the female child back to the fisherman, naming her Matsyagandha. The fisherman raised the girl as his daughter and named her Kali because of her complexion. Over the course of time, Kali earned the name of Satyavati. The fisherman was working as a ferryman. His job was to ferry people across the river and Yamuna in his boat. Satyavati helped her father, the fisherman, in his job and grew up to be a beautiful maiden. Once, when Satyavati was ferrying the Rishi Parasara across the river Yamuna, the sage was very attracted to her and held her hand, and he asked Satyavati to satisfy his lust. She tried to dissuade Parasara, saying that a learned Brahmin of his stature should not desire a woman who stinks of fish. So she kept procrastinating, and the sage was adamant to have her. She finally gave in, realizing the desperation and persistence of the sage, and feared that if she did not heed his request, he might cause a catastrophe and she might drown in the river. Kali agreed and told Parasara to be patient until the boat reached the banks. On reaching the other side, the sage grabbed her again, but she declared that her body stank and coitus should be delighted to both of them. On these words, the Matsyagandha was transformed into a Yognagandha, which means someone who smelt of fragrance and musk. This was due to the blessings of the sage Parasara. She now smelled of musk, and she was also called as Kasturi Gandhi because of this. And Parasara transformed the fisherwoman into a beautiful girl and started seducing Satyavati. He also promised to give her chastity back again. Parasara was tormented with desire, so he approached Satyavati again. But she this time said that they should wait till night because the powerful sages and this entire area would be filled with sages who come there to take a bath and dip in the holy river. So Parasara, with his power, shrouded the entire area into fog so that nobody could see them. Satyavati again interrupted to him and said that he would enjoy her and depart, robbing her of her virginity and leaving her shamed in society. She asked Parasara to promise her that the coitus would be a secret and her virginity intact. The son, thus born from their union, would be as famous as a great sage, and her fragrance and youth will be eternal. Parasara granted her these wishes and was satiated by the beautiful Satyavati. After the act, the sage left, never to meet her again. The Mahabharata abridges the story, noting only two wishes for Satyavati, her coitus intact and everlasting sweet fragrance. Ecstatic with her blessings, Satyavati gave birth the same day to her baby on an island in the Yamuna. The son immediately grew up to be a youth and promised his mother that he would come to her aid every time she called on him. He then left to the penance in the forest. The son was called as Vyasa, the compiler of the Vedas and the author of the Puranas and the Mahabharata. This fulfilled Parashara's prophecy, and thus Satyavati returned home to help her father. After a few years, Santanu, the Kuru king of Hastinapura, came to the forest on a hunting trip and was mesmerized by the musk fragrance emanating from Satyavati. Allured by her sweet scent, Santanu reached Satyavati's house and seeing her, fell in love. The king asked the fisherman chief for his daughter's hand, and the fisherman Dasharaja said his daughter would marry the king if and only if her sons would inherit the throne. The king was shocked and dejected. He returned to the palace since he had already appointed his son Devavrata, who was mothered by goddess Ganga as is apparent here. Devavrata was distressed by his father's condition. He learned about the promise asked by the fisherman chief from the minister. Immediately, Devavrata rushed to the hut of the fisherman chief and begged for Satyavati's hand on his father's behalf. The fisherman repeated his condition and told Devavrata that only Shantanu was worthy of Satyavati. So he had rejected marriage proposal from even Brahmanshris like Asita. Devavrata wanted to know what exactly was his concern. So he renounced his claim to the throne in favor of Satyavati's son once he heard the fisherman's condition. The fisherman was contented that Devavrata's children might dispute his grandson's claim. Intensely, Devavrata pledged the terrible vow of Brahmacharya, the vow of celibacy. The fisherman immediately gave Satyavati to Devavrata, who was henceforth called Bhishma. Bhishma presented Satyavati to Shantanu, who married her. After they married, Satyavati bore Shantanu two sons, Chitrangada and Vichitravarya. The Harivamsha tells of Bhishma recalling events after Shantanu's death. During the period of mourning after Shantanu's death, Ugrayudha Purava demanded that Bhishma hand over Satyavati in return for wealth. Bhishma killed Ugrayapurva, who had lost his powers because he lusted after another's wife. However, the Mahabharata does not include this event. It only describes Bhishma crowning Chitrangada as king under Satyavati's command. Chitrangada was later killed by a namesake Gandharva. After Chitrangada's death, his younger brother Vichitravarya was crowned king, while Bhishma ruled on his behalf. The childless Vichitravarya met with an untimely death from tuberculosis. He was married to princess of Kosala, Ambika and Ambalika. With no heir to the throne, Satyavati asked Bhishma to marry the widows of Vichitravarya and rule as king. Bhishma refused, reminding Satyavati of the promise he made to his father and his vow of bachelorhood. He suggested that a Brahman could be hired to father children of the widows. Satyavati calls her son Vyasa and coaxed him to have Niyoga with his brother's widows, saying, "From affection for thy brother Vichitravarya, for the perpetuation of our dynasty, and for the sake of this Bhishma's request and my command, and for the protection of the people from the liberty of thy heart, I request thee to bless them with children." After convincing Vyasa, Satyavati managed to obtain the consent of her virtuous daughter-in-laws. Vyasa agreed to the Niyoga. In the Devi Bhagavata Purana version, Vyasa initially refused Satyavati's proposal. He argued that Vichitravarya's wives were like his daughters. Having Niyoga with them was a heinous sin, through which no good should come. As a matter of fact, the hungry for grandsons, Satyavati asserted that to preserve the dynasty, wrong directives by elders should be followed if they are going to reduce the sorrow of a mother. Vyasa finally agreed to that disgusting task, but suggested that the offspring of preservity cannot be a source of joy. So Satyavati sent Vyasa to Ambika's bedchamber. During the physical act with Vyasa, Ambika noticed his dark complexion and closed her eyes. Vyasa declared to Satyavati that due to Ambika's cruelty, her son would be blind and have 100 sons, later known as Kauravas. Satyavati considered such an hire to be an unworthy king. So she asked Vyasa to have Niyoga with her younger daughter-in-law. During their Niyoga, Ambalika fell pale due to Vyasa's grim appearance. As a result, the child would be van. Vyasa told his mother, who begged for another child. In due course, the blind Dhritarashtra and the pale Pandu were born. Satyavati once again coaxes Vyasa to Ambika's bedchamber. She remembered Vyasa's grim appearance and substituted Ashudra, a maid, in her place. The maid respected the sage and was not afraid of him. So Vyasa thus blessed her with a son, and he would be the most intelligent man and she would no longer be a slave. Vyasa told Satyavati of the deception and then disappeared. Vidura, an incarnation of god Dharma, was born to the maid. Consequently, due to Dhritarashtra's blindness and Vidura's birth from a maid, Pandu was crowned king of Hastinapura. However, he was cursed that he could not bear any children, renounced the kingdom and went to the forest with his wives Kunti and Madri. There, His wives had the Pandavas. Pandu died in the forest. Madri ended her life with her husband. Kunti returned to Hastinapura with the Pandavas, and the grief was stricken to Satyavati as her grandson's untimely death, and she did not wish to live any longer. After the funerary rites of Pandu, Vyasa warned Satyavati that happiness would end the dynasty and devastating events would occur in the future, which she would not be able to bear in her old age. At Vyasa's suggestion, Satyavati left for the forest to do penance with her daughter-in-laws Ambika and Ambalika. It is said that in the forest, she died and attained heaven. Within a few days, her daughter-in-laws died too. For Satyavati, the end matters, not the means. Satyavati's life goal and ambition was to ensure that the succession of the Shantanu's lineage and inheritance of his fortune by her sons, but ironically, Bhishma, whose right to the throne Satyavati snatched, outlives her children in life and in fame. Her action creates a generation of encompassed by a greed which ultimately leads to its annihilation. Satyavati's story teaches the new generation women that determination and commitment are different from avarice and calculation. One should know where greed takes over ambition.